Here we're going to look at the ScreenPoint 16 groundwater sampler, assembly, installation, and sampling. Basic parts of the tool are the expendable point with O-ring, the screen sheath here, and the screen sheath is tapered on one end to capture the head of the screen so the screen is recovered after sampling. So we'll just install the expendable point. Okay, and I need a hard surface to push on. Okay, the expendable point is on. Now we have the stainless steel screen here, and we have the grout plug on the left. This is a wire wound stainless screen with four slot opening in the screen. That's 4/1000ths of an inch, or about 0.1 millimeter opening. And an O-ring on the screen head, and you can see the screen head's a little larger diameter. That catches in the narrow end of the screen sheath to be recovered after sampling. So we simply take the screen with the grout plug on the end, hold it up, and drop the screen in place so the screen is installed, and then put on the screen head. There's an O-ring on the bottom and an O-ring on the top for assembly. And the O-rings provide us a seal, so we have a watertight system as the tool is advanced to depth. So now we have the assembled ScreenPoint groundwater sampler with the drive head, and I've added a friction reducer here to help reduce friction as we're driving the tool down, so it'll drive a little easier for us. So we'll simply set up under the probe and get our rod wiper in place so we can clean tools when they come out. And then we'll start advancing the tool after we kind of plumb it up. Now, as we're advancing, we want to put O-rings on the rods and the O-ring grooves to provide us with a good seal, so we have a high integrity system for sampling, so we don't have water coming in at each rod joint as we go down the hole. So we use O-rings on each rod joint to provide for high integrity sampling. Install the O-ring in the O-ring groove, and then I'll wet the next rod and put it on. So for high integrity sampling at each rod joint after the tool is advanced, then we add the O-ring, wet the female end of the rod, and install the next rod to give us a good sealed system. Now we advance to our target interval, and from our OIHPT log, we ran just a few feet over here. We saw we have a good sand layer, and we're going to go for a total target depth of 45 feet and then open the screen 2 to 3 feet over the interval there where it's nice and sandy. Okay, we've advanced the tool string to depth, checking with our water level indicator. This is a little older model water level indicator, but we can tag bottom with this, pull it back to correct for our stick up here, and we are just a couple inches shy of 45 feet, right where we want to be. Our OIHPT log showed us that in this interval, We have low EC and low pressure, so we're in a nice sandy material. And the image from the OIP log also showed us sandy material here. So hopefully we'll get good water recharge. And now I'll just trip this out, our water level indicator. Okay, and this guy is still dry, just a little water on the end, probably from where we added water to lubricate the rods. So next what I'll do is I'll retract the mast of the machine and add another rod, lower the mast, put the rod grip on, and then we'll trip in with our screen push adapter and our extension rods to hold the screen in place, and then retract the outer rods as we hold the screen in position at approximately 45 feet. Now this is the little screen push adapter that will hold the screen in position at depth. Okay, so we lowered the extension rods, and this is now resting on the bottom of the screen. The expendable point is still in place. And what we're gonna do here is measure off and retract the rods approximately 2 feet so that we expose 2 feet of screen to the formation for water to come into the sampler. So I'm just gonna measure off 2 feet plus an inch to account for the expendable point on the end of the sampler here. Let's try doing this like so. Okay. So now we'll retract the rods to open the screen. And then continue retracting the screen. Okay, now we're to our 2 foot interval is open and the screen is exposed. So next we'll take off its upper rod and then trip out our extension rods. Sometimes it's good to have a second man to help with that little deal. And our screen push adapter. So now we'll check our water level. Often it takes a little while for the water to rise, especially after you initially open the screen. So this gives a little audible beep when you tag the water level here. Looks like the water level's still rising some here. We'll check what the level is now. Okay. Pull back to take off the height of the stick up here. And right now we're just about 29 feet and 10 inches below grade for the water level. It'll probably come up some more. Next, what we'll do, we'll trip the water level indicator out. Well, first, let's check our total depth and see exactly where the bottom of our screen is. I'll turn the beeper off. And as we had to kind of bump the screen to keep it going out, sometimes that happens at these depths. We'll see if our screen came up a little bit in our process here. Just tagging the bottom of the screen. Okay. And pretty good. Depth here is 44.5 feet. So it looks like we came up a couple of inches when we retracted the screen, but we're pretty close to our desired depth. So 44.5 feet. Now I'll trip this out and we'll set up and purge with the check valve. Okay, this is a simple tubing check valve and we'll install this on the bottom of this polyethylene tubing. The polyethylene tubing is 3/8 inch OD, 1/4 inch ID, and this will allow us to purge water from the sampler to the surface for development and then for sampling. Okay. And so this simply screws on to the tubing, and I usually try to screw it on about 1/2 inch. Okay, so now we've installed the tubing check valve on the end of our polyethylene tubing, and we'll simply insert it in the rods and lower it down hole. And we'll lower this down till we get to the sample interval inside the screen interval. I have a little assistance helping roll the tubing off of the roll for me, so this goes a little smoother. So just installing the check valve with our polyethylene tubing. Okay, hold on, Troy. Yeah, so we just hit the top of the screen head here. We get a little bump as we hit the top of the screen head and we twist it so the check valve passes through the screen head and on down to the bottom of the screen. And I'll back off the bottom of the screen a little bit and then we'll cut the tubing, leave us a little extra tubing here. And there we go. Okay. I'm going to grab another vice grip here to hold my sample line in place on the bucket so we can purge into our sample, purge into the bucket to develop our sampler screen. Okay. So what you do here is just manually oscillate the tubing up and down. And here you can see some muddy water starting to come out of the screen. And I can turn this around a little bit. Is that going to work? So even in relatively clean sands, we usually get pretty turbid water on the initial purging and development. The check valve is a very inexpensive and quick way to purge and develop the screen. And in many cases, with this tool, you're just looking for hot spots. Is there contamination in place or not? So you're not worried about low turbidity samples sometimes. So the check valve is a good way just to get a quick sample and determine if contamination is present. Then if you need a better quality sample, we also have a mechanical bladder pump or small diameter syringe pump that you can run in this groundwater sampler to purge and get higher quality, lower turbidity samples. Okay, so we'll just continue to purging until we get our turbidity to drop some. Typically flow rates, if you have good yield from the formation, will be between 200 and 500 mils a minute like this. And often I'll purge 1 to 3 gallons to try to get the turbidity lower and then take a sample. Okay, we've been purging about 10 minutes, 8 to 10 minutes, and we've got about 2 gallons or so. That's pretty typical. It's still a bit turbid, but the turbidity has dropped a good bit. So now we could stop and take a sample if we wanted with the check valve. As I mentioned earlier, you can also change and put in a mechanical bladder pump if you're sampling for volatile contaminants, or you could put in a syringe pump if you're sampling for something like PFAS compounds, the polyfluorinated compounds. So I have our sample bottle here, and I'm just going to try to do a three-handed job with 2 hands. So we just purge, hopefully with a little help from your coworker. You can simply purge the sample bottle full of water to collect your sample. And then, of course, the sample is labeled. You fill out your chain of custody form, put it on ice in the cooler, and then send your sample to the lab for analysis. Okay. So, quick way to get a groundwater sample with a screen .16 groundwater sampler. Here we had about a 2-foot length of screen open to the formation to purge from. This allows us to access groundwater at various depths below the surface, purge and sample. We can also check the water level to see what the piezometric surface is here. Additionally, we can actually attach a pneumatic head to this groundwater sampler and run a pneumatic slug test. And that will enable us to get a measurement of the hydraulic conductivity of the formation over this interval where we're screened. So now we've removed our tubing check valve from the screen .16 groundwater sampler. Next, we'll use the rod grit system to pull the tools out and recover the screen. And then before we go to a next location, we go through a decontamination, clean the tools before using it at a next location so we don't have cross-contamination. There's actually an ASTM standard, ASTM D5088, that provides guidance on decontamination of tools used at contaminated sites. So you can trip the tools out, decon, go to the next location, and do more sampling. After we trip out here, or as we're tripping out here, we can actually use a pressure grouting method. We have a grout pump and a grout hose and a pull head for the grout that allow us to inject grout under pressure as we pull the tool out, so we can grout with bentonite slurry from the bottom of the hole up. So that will give us a good high integrity seal with pressure grouting. Another option is if you're working very shallow, only 8 or 10 feet below the surface, you can trip the tool out and simply do bentonite chips and pour the chips in from the surface to grout a shallow boring that way. Just another option for shallow borings. Okay, so good for the screen .16 sampler here.